sort of the state budget situation, sort of overall things really quick. So, the way we do things in Richmond is we do a two-year budget, and right after our election cycle, which was in 2015, we enacted a two-year budget, and we did that last year. That's the long session. That's the 60-day long session. And then when we come back in the short session, which is this year, which is a 45-day session, we do little tweaks and changes to that budget based on changes in revenue projections or other things that might have occurred over the last year. So that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing this year. And coming into this session, it was announced that we had a $1.5 billion, you might call it a deficit, you might call it a shortfall. I mean, the reality is that the revenues didn't come in as projected over the, both over the year that had occurred and the year we were looking forward. And so we had to go back and, we have to go back and readjust our budget based on the fact that our revenues aren't what we expected. Expenses, there's no really big change in the expenses, but the revenue is all out of whack. The good news, though, is over the last 4 months, I guess, they decided that the revenues would come back better, so the shortfall isn't as big as we thought, but the money committees haven't really told us what revenue assumptions they're going to be using for the budget, so we don't really know exactly how much money we're working with, but it's not as bad as we thought it was, which is good, but we're all still waiting to see what all this means. One thing we definitely know means is that last year, in our big budget, we had included money for a 3% raise for teachers all over the state. You know, the funding of education is both a state and a local combined thing. And so what we do is we say, localities, if you raise your teachers by 3%, here's the state's share of that money to pay for that. But that allocation was contingent on our revenue hitting certain benchmark, which it didn't do. So that teacher raise got canceled. Localities could do it if they wanted to do, but the state share didn't happen. And given that the state pays 50% of the education budget in Prince William County, that pretty much meant Prince William County wasn't going to do it. Okay, so that raise is still on ice. What we found out, I think about 2 days ago, the money committees in the Senate, it's called the Finance Committee, in the House they have a Finance Committee also, but it doesn't do the budget. They have an Appropriations Committee. And those two committees announced that they've reached an agreement, although they haven't shown it to us, to give state employees a raise. I think it's like either a 1% or 2% raise. State employees have gotten, I think, one or two raises in 8 years. And to give our state police a really big raise, but not teachers. So that's, I think, what you're likely to hear at about, officially here, when they announce their actual budget. That comes out in about 10 days or about 2 weeks, but that's at least one preview we've been given about what they're aiming towards. And just to understand about our state police, starting salary for a state trooper today in the state of Virginia is $36,000. And we have been hemorrhaging state troopers over the last 2 years now. And as somebody, when I'm not being a senator, I do divorces, car accidents, DUIs, I do sort of real people legal work. And I've actually won 3 DUIs in the last 12 months now because the state trooper left the force before trial came up. Okay? So, this has real consequences in terms of public safety, in terms of in lots of things. And actually, as taxpayers, what really ought to make people upset about it is that taxpayers actually spend about $55,000 per trooper training them. And getting them up to speed. They have to go through, they have to go to the academy, and it takes about 6 months. They each make a 3-year commitment when they sign up. And what happens is, as soon as a lot of them hit their 3 years, they either go to Fairfax or Arlington or Alexandria. I had one guy on a case, he went in with some federal agency, he went to CIA, he went to Protective Services for CIA. In Texas, they start their troopers at 65,000. So a lot of them have just been moving to Texas. We got to get our state trooper paid up, and that's been a big priority this session. We've actually cut the state police by about $150 million over the last 7 years. Actually cut them. Anyways, that's been a big focus on the budget side of things, is getting our state employees funded. Given the lack of money, there has not been a lot of real initiatives otherwise on the budget side. We put a big new slug of money into K-12 last year. I think that's going to be off limits. They haven't, you know, again, we haven't seen the final proposal yet. The governor made it off limits in his proposal. But, you know, there's a three-way conversation going on here. It's the House, the Senate, the governor. Everybody has to agree. And I'm not on the money committee, so I'm not party to all that. Good news, though, is that you're, a lot of your Prince William legislators are in the discussion. Delegate Anderson is on the Appropriations Committee. Delegate Lingenfelter is on Appropriations. You have Delegate Miller up in Manassas. He's in leadership, so he's kind of in the middle of that. Most importantly, Delegate Torian is actually a budget conferee. What that means is that when they negotiate the final budget, he's one of the seven people in the room in the House of Delegates that actually gets to negotiate the final budget. It's a very important position. And, you know, Delegate Torian represents everything from Woodbridge down to Dumfries along the west side of Route 1. So it's good to have him in there looking out for Prince William. So anyways, that discussion is ongoing. I put in a few budget amendments when my agendas show up. You can take a look at them. I don't think any of them really directly relate to Prince William. I see we have a few people here from Belmont. You all be happy to know I put in a budget amendment again to try and get the derelict barge in Belmont Bay cleaned up. There's no barge that's been sitting out there for 12 years from Hurricane Isabel that blew in, and nobody will pull it out. It takes about $150,000 to chop it up and pull it out, and I put in an amendment to pay for that. You guys are kind of close to Stafford. One of the things that excited me about when I became a state senator is that the 36th Senate District actually includes two national parks, the George Washington Parkway and Prince William Forest Park. It includes three federal wildlife refuges. All of them are right over here, right along the river. And it includes three state parks. My delegate seat didn't have any state parks, any federal wildlife refuges, only had one national park. But three state parks. And Lee Sylvania, which is, you know, right down the road here, gets so full you can't even get in on weekends because there's so much demand for it. And the state, we just broke ground on Whitewater State Park about 2 months ago. I was at the ribbon cutting for that. We got money in the last budget for phase one. It's a three-phase opening of it. And I put in more money to do fund phase two of that park. But Whitewater, it's just below Quantico. About a 1,200-acre state park they're going to open up. It's going to have, when it's done, they have boat launch, canoe launch, cabins, picnic areas. It's 1,200 acres on the Potomac. And the widest part of the Potomac River down there. So anyways, and hopefully that'll take some of the demand off of Lee Sylvania so that it's not so pressured by people. So anyways, I put in a budget amendment for that, but given the lack of money, I'm not sure it'll get funded, but Delegate Dudenheffer, the eastern part of Route 1 is Delegate Dudenheffer, who, by the way, isn't running again. He's announced he's not running again, but Widewater State Park is a big deal for him. And he and I are trying to put some money in the budget to get some bathrooms built there. So we'll see what happens. So legislation-wise, again, I put in about 40 bills. Some of the ones that have been getting, you've probably heard about if you read the paper. Number one is I put in a bill to require to make it illegal to drive a car if you have a phone in your hand while the car is moving. That's something that I've cared a lot about for probably about 4 or 5 years now. I was contacted by a family about 4 years ago whose 18-year-old son was killed by a texting driver up in Herndon. His name was Kyle Rowley. He was home from college. He was trying to make some money at a Jack in the Box on the way home from work one night in Sterling. He was driving up Route 70, he ran out of gas, and he turned on his blinkers, he was pushing his car off the road. He's about 10 yards from the stoplight. He was just trying to get his car to the stoplight, and he was struck by a guy from behind. Had 1,000 feet of clear road between him and where he struck my client, the deceased kid. Hit him at full speed without braking. Had 1,000 feet to see him. And, you know, it's a longer than a football field. And, you know, the cars went rolling and, you know, he was killed instantly, et cetera. When they pulled the driver's phone, he'd been texting his ex-wife the entire way from a child custody exchange in Leesburg all the way to where he struck this guy. And, you know, the police wanted to see his phone because they couldn't understand how you could run right into a car with his blinkers on, no other cars in the road. and without breaking. So that really sort of woke me up to how dangerous this is. And I read a lot of studies about it, and you know, the studies are just pretty universal in terms of how dangerous it is. Most people think it's more dangerous than drunk driving. When you actually look at what if you're going 60 miles an hour, the average text takes about 4 seconds, takes your eyes off the road for an average of 4 seconds. At 88 miles an hour, that means you're not looking at the road for the distance of a football field. And so it's pretty easy to see how you can have this. You know, there was a woman whose infant was killed in a baby carriage in Leesburg about 3 months ago. And they're pretty sure that person was texting. I don't know how you run into a woman with a baby carriage if you're not texting while driving in the parking lot. So, anyways, that legislation was heard in the Transportation Committee. It died by one vote because a lot of my Republican colleagues don't like the government sort of dictating behavior in vehicles like that. They think it's sort of big nanny state government, and it sets a bad precedent for the government to be able to dictate personal behavior, and that's part of it. I also got a lot of, are you a reporter?
No, I'm just taking notes.
Okay. All right. Well, I also got a lot of people saying things like, well, I do that all the time, or, you know, I have 16 cars and 8 of them don't have Bluetooth, or things like that. So, I mean, these are some of the responses I got from some of my fellow legislators, not on the stand, but trying to, you know, lobby them about it ahead of time. The good news is the chairman of the committee he's a former state trooper, and he is open to doing something about it. He thought I was a little bit too aggressive by making it reckless driving, and he said if I made a traffic offense, he'd support it, but he still wouldn't let me bring my bill back. But luckily, I got some of my Republican colleagues in the House to introduce my bill in the House at the very last minute, and so that bill is actually working through from the other side. And the problem is over there, the Republicans in the House are all big on tough on crime, and so they want to make it reckless driving, which the chairman of the Transportation Committee doesn't want to be. And so I'm trying to mediate a solution between them to try and get something through. And we might actually see something come through this year, which would be huge. Virginia, I think the 14th state to go hands-free. Right now, D.C. and Maryland already do it. And so, you know, I've heard from people all around the state about that legislation, actually. So I'm hoping to do that. Another thing you've heard about is if, you know, those of us who live, you know, where we all live, the Potomac River is right next door. And I found out, I guess I've known for about 5 years that Alexandria was putting raw sewage in the Potomac. I didn't realize the urgency of it until about, I guess about 6 months ago, the Potomac Riverkeeper organization came to me and said that Alexandria was looking for a permit to get their plan to get rid of raw sewage approved by the Virginia Department of Environmental Quality. They have 4 pipes. Basically, Alexandria has what's called a combined sewer. Back in the late 1800s, it was state of the art to have your toilet water and your street water going to the same pipe and then just send it in the river. And they still have that in place. So today, anytime it rains more than 1/10 of an inch, raw sewage in Alexandria goes into the Potomac. I'm talking water from a toilet, okay? Not just water from the street. And it's about 130 million gallons per year. And there's 4 pipes. And Alexandria has a plan to deal with the 3 of the pipes. But there's a 4th pipe that puts 70 million of those 130 million into Orinoco Bay, which if any of y'all know Old Town, it's like maybe about 3 streets north of King Street. There's a big park right on the water. Right there, the pipe goes right into the river. And that's why there's a lot of vegetation and stuff growing there, because it's a lot of nutrients in the water. And I put in a bill that would require them to fix that within 10 years. After I started talking about it, Delegate Albo, Republican delegate from, he has Mason Neck and sort of up through Wharton, Dave decided he wanted to put in a bill also, so he put in a bill. And Doug Lingenfelter, who's got, he sort of has Dale City, then runs up into Fauquier County, Montclair, that area. Doug Lingenfelter, he's chairman of the Chesapeake Bay Commission. He put in a bill. And then Then the chairman of the Senate Ag Committee, Ag does environmental stuff in the Senate, he put in a bill. Because he has the northern neck, and he basically has all these people that make their money, you know, doing oysters and menhaden and all that, and so water quality is huge for his constituents. He put in a bill, except his said instead of having 10 years, they have 3. And that gave Alexandria a heart attack, because they were already planning on spending about $180 million, but this last pipe will cost about $150 million to fix. And they had other plans for $150 million, let's just say that. And building a $150 million tunnel, it's kind of hard to do in 3 years. So anyways, we had a big fight about that. The deal we ended up brokering was 8 years. And there's still bills coming through from the House on that. We haven't reached a total agreement, but I think it's going to be probably somewhere either 8 to 10 years, something like that. Alexandria's going to have to fix this. But it's something that, you know, affects all of us. You know, Alexandria wanted to... Senator Evan, who represents Alexandria, he put in a bill. His bill gave him until 2029 to study it, and then fix it after that. And so he basically wanted to propose that they, you know, put another, you know, billion and a half gallons of sewage in the river, and instead of fixing it right now. And so, anyways, I think we're gonna get some solutions. I think we're gonna get a solution on that. Did you have a question? Is there a hand?
Yeah, doesn't the Chesapeake Bay Preservation Act of '88 drive that? You're talking 3 to 10 years, but that was enacted in 88 with the phased implementation. And I'll drive that as well as Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
and their sewage plants.
Yeah, I mean, if you want, we can really get into the details of it. But what happened was that, you know, EPA wasn't doing anything. The act was put in place, but EPA wasn't enforcing it. And there were a bunch of lawsuits that got the EPA for consent decree to start and actually enforcing the Chesapeake Bay Act.
Well, I thought the DEQ at the state level was starting to enforce it.
They were. And DEQ got, there's 3 combined sewer operations in Virginia. There's Alexandria, Lynchburg, and Richmond. Those were like the 3 sort of biggest urban thing, you know, concentrations in Virginia back in the late 1800s. That's why they're the 3 that have these sewers like this. Richmond and Lynchburg are already cleaning theirs up. Richmond had 29 pipes going into the James. Right? I mean, Alexandria only had 4. I don't remember. Lynchburg, I think, about 15, maybe. But what happened was is that DEQ has been making everybody do it. The problem with Orinoco Bay is that Alexandria's other 3 pipes go into one creek. And it was really easy to look at that one creek and to figure out what to do and how to test the water and decide where that was coming from. The problem with Orinoco Bay water is that Orinoco Bay is on this, has billions of gallons of water right next to it, the Potomac River. And the Potomac is governed by the District of Columbia, and the district's environmental compliance agency, I don't know what they call it there, probably called the District Environmental Quality Office or something. But, and the District of Columbia has already done a bunch of studies, and I don't know if anybody wants to get into what a TMDL is, but Orinoco Bay, in order to go through a Clean Water Act compliance process, it would be really difficult from a scientific and legal perspective to figure out where that water in the bay is coming from, because it's in and out with the tides, and because it's right next to all that big river. And so DEQ had, it was one of the most complex things they had to do, so it was sort of last on their list. And when I went to them, they said, you know, we'd really just like a bill. If you just put in a piece of legislation, tell us what to do, we'd rather do that than have to jump through all the hoops of the Clean Water Act. And so that's what I did. But that's why it was the last one.
Thank you.
So, anyways, that's moving along, and I'm excited about that, because I think we're going to get a solution on that. Another thing, which I think is important to, actually at Prince William County, is I have a bill that would require the TMB to start issuing driving permits to everybody regardless of their immigration status. And, you know, the 36th district that I represent is actually 23% Latino. I mean, you wouldn't look at this room here today, right? I mean, I don't think there's anybody here who's Latino, right? But my seat has a huge Latino population, and Virginia stopped providing any kind of ID, official government ID, to people that can't prove their immigration status. I think it was in 2003, after 9/11, and It's become a real problem for folks because they, if you don't have a license of some kind, you can't open a bank account. Aside from that, you're driving around illegally all the time. You can't really live. And, you know, we heard testimony from folks who can't take their children to soccer without fear of being, you know, arrested, can't take somebody to the doctor. There's one woman who said that her husband had a license, but she didn't, and then she got cancer. So he would drive her to the doctor. He ended up losing his job because he had to, you know, he was losing time off of work from all the chemos he had to do. I had another woman, you know, explain to me how she has to walk through the woods to take her kid to daycare because she doesn't want to drive a car. College student, George Mason, actually, told me this. She told us this committee. Again, a Republican delegate is carrying the exact same bill I had on the other side. He's from the Eastern Shore. There's a lot of migrant workers that come in there that work their farms out there, and they have a lot of tomato farms, a lot of canneries, a lot of aquaculture, fishing stuff, anyways. And that bill failed by one vote in the Transportation Committee for the second year in a row. And it was vetted by the DMV. The Department of Motor Vehicles looked at it, thought it was a great idea. It's been done by 12 states. And the states that have done it, they actually have a 10% lower accident rate. People think that's because it actually takes, they found it in the states that have implemented it, that new drivers that try to pass the driving test, it usually takes them 3 times to pass. And it's because they don't, I mean, aside from language barrier, they also just don't know the rules of the road here. They don't know what the signs mean, they don't know what the striping means, they don't know, like, when to stop pass for a school bus, you know, I mean, there's things we all learn when we take our driving test that they just have never had to learn, and the rules are different, right? So number one is you get people to learn the rules of the road. Secondly, the rate of hit-and-run accidents goes way down. They estimate that about 45% of people who are in hit-and-runs are actually people who are unlicensed, and the reason they run is because they don't have a license. But if you get people a license, they actually stop, and you get their insurance company involved, and then the right people end up paying for the collision instead of, you know, it not being paid for, or your insurance company having to pay for it, etc. So hit-and-run accidents go way down. People also are more likely to interact with the police, whether it's for domestic violence cases or more serious crimes. If people have ID, they're not so concerned about talking to law enforcement whenever something bad happens. Another thing is that my legislation would require, in order to get a license, you have to show you pay Virginia income taxes. And the reason that's important is that they're estimating there's about 300,000 people who would benefit from this. That if we were to go do this, that they would immediately go and sign up for a license. If you've got 300,000 people to file a Virginia income tax return today that claim they made $35,000 a year, they would each pay about $1,700 in taxes. Okay? You multiply that by 300,000, it comes out to around $500 million. Okay? So, the budget deficit we have, it's about $700 million a year, okay? So you want to close our budget hole, get all these people to pay taxes and get that underground economy out, and get people to start, you know, declaring all the cash they're receiving for doing, you know, drywalling or carpentry or house cleaning or all these other things, you'd actually save us some money by getting everybody into the system, getting them to pay taxes. Also, whenever you have auto insurance, you actually pay an auto insurance premium tax on your auto insurance policy. That's probably worth another $100, $120 million a year if all those people get auto insurance and then actually get auto insurance and start paying. So there's real economic benefit to getting folks incentivized to get into the system. And, you know, some people say, why would people actually, if they weren't legally present, actually go and give the government their address and show up and tell them where they are? And it's because they want to be able to live. And they'll do it. Other states they found they've done it. And we also set the license fee in a place that it would cost the Department of Motor Vehicles nothing. We set it, I think it's, what was it, Indian? It's like $51 or something like that to start, and $25 a year after that or something. I can't remember, but.
No, that's about right. It's around $50 to start and then $25.
Yeah, and it would actually create about 100 to 150 new jobs in the DMV. And it would pay for itself. Doug at Bloxham actually wants to charge $200. He thinks we ought to make money on it. And you know, I went to the Latino community and said, what do you think people would pay? They said $500. Like, people really, really want this. And it is the number one issue in the Latino community. When I had a Latino town hall about 2 years ago, I said, you know, I talked about Medicaid and schools, all this stuff. I said, what do you guys want to talk about? They said licenses. So, you have a question?
But don't you think the current climate and rhetoric would influence negatively people deciding they want to get their license?
It's possible. I'm not sure. I mean, that's all brand new. And I haven't heard anything from the advocates about, you know, other states, you know, people, you know, I don't know how well you'd surrender your license or move or something, but, you know, I can tell you there's a whole lot of fear out there. I mean, you know, I've heard from a lot of Latinos in my district. A lot of them, you know, are on my social media pages and stuff. And that's how I actually tend to hear from that community. I don't get a lot of emails or phone calls. I hear from them on Facebook, Twitter. But yeah, that might be an issue. But we'll see how that plays out.
Well, kind of along those lines then, because of the current climate, I mean, would the license bill to get through? I mean, what's the likelihood?
Oh, it already died in committee by one vote. And I don't know what's happened on the House side, and I'm not sure if the other that Republican legislation on the House side died. There was some talk about it. There's also a compromise position that there's like about five or six classes of visas where we don't give licenses right now. And there's some talk about at least getting those into the system. But the agendas came. Excellent. All right. Let me have one.
Thank you.
Not on my computer, right? So what else? I told you, I put in about 40 bills, and I think about half of them are going to clear the Senate, maybe a little more than half. We'll see about the House. One other bill I'm really proud of, which has already passed the Senate, is a bill to regulate internet lending. And I don't know if y'all remember how much you were paying attention to the stuff I sent out during my campaign, but one of the things that really makes me angry is car title lending. These guys in Room 1, like Title Max, Lung Max, all those guys, there's 21, or there used to be 21 car title lenders between the Wilson Bridge and Quantico. 21, more than McDonald's, right? And actually, two of them closed down in Hyde Valley in the last 6 months, which really surprised me. But car title lenders are completely legal, and they are allowed by Virginia law to lend money to people at 267% interest. Okay? 30% per month, which comes out to 267% APR. So, and they do a bustling business. Like, I think they made 170,000 car title loans last year in the state of Virginia. And it's totally legal. There's all kinds of restrictions on how they do business, but they're making a killing. A lot of people confuse it with payday lending, which Virginia highly restricted back in 2009, right before I was elected. Payday lending is a big problem in other states, not as much here. But what happened is, when we got rid of payday lending, when we told the payday lenders they could only lend money at 36%, they switched over to using what are called open-end loans, open-end credit loans, which are like lines of credit. And instead of having payday loans, they give people a new line of credit every month. Got unlimited interest rates. And so this year I put in a bill that says that if you're going to use open-end credit lines like this, you're going to be subject to the same restrictions the payday lenders have to live on. That bill failed by a party line vote. Because basically all these payday lenders have gone around the restrictions we enacted and used a different system to do the same thing. That bill failed, but there's another type of predatory lender that's popped up in the last 4 years. There are Native American Indian tribes who have joined forces with these predatory lenders to lend money from their foreign country and to use their immunity that they have to lend money. And there are companies from other countries that are coming in and lending money over the internet. And with those internet lenders, we've seen interest rates between 300% and 5,000%. And so I put in a bill this year to say that if you're going to lend money over the internet, that is, if you don't have a physical presence, you don't have an office in Virginia or an office on Route 1, you're just going to do it only over the internet, that you're subject to regulation by Virginia's Bureau of Financial Institutions. And that bill was poised to pass the Senate, but we were sticking them into this box with these other companies, legit companies that have been around since 1915, and they started to have apoplexy, that they were getting put in the same box as these guys. And they said they would prefer the internet lender guys have a whole separate box to be in instead of being in their box. They didn't want to have to deal with all the chaos these guys are creating in their business, right? So I amended my bill on the floor to say that the Bureau of Financial Institutions has to come up with a system for regulating these internet lenders. And that the bill I passed, which says they're going to be regulated, has to be reenacted next year in order to become law. And so, I mean, given the support I've seen in the Senate and what I've seen in the House, I think next year the Bureau of Financial Institutions is going to come back with a system to put these guys into some kind of a regulatory system. We're going to pass that. To me, it's real positive news. I mean, there's bipartisan hatred for these guys in the legislature. Okay, so anyways, we finally got some movement on that. And I'd like to do other things to car title lenders. I'd like to get rid of the 267% car title lending, all that stuff, but that ain't happening. I'm the biggest critic of those guys in the entire body. I can tell you right now that's here to stay for a while. Anyways, that's something that I'm doing. It's actually moving along, huh?
Who is it in Richmond who thinks that's okay?
Yeah.
Well, let me put it this way. I mean, there's no Democrats that do. And all Republicans don't either. It's not entirely a partisan thing. But I can just tell you that my Republican colleagues tend to be more sort of free market oriented. And it's their attitude that if people ought to be accountable for their own judgments, and that, you know, if somebody's willing to go in there and sign something that says I'm paying 267% interest, why should the government stop that from happening? There's some people that feel very strongly about that. These guys also throw around a lot of campaign contributions. And, I've never taken a penny from any of them, but that can influence people some ways. I mean, I think they'll be able to say that, but you know, the committees that these bills go through tend to get people put on them that favor certain industries, right? I mean, like, you know, odds are I'm not going to be getting on the Commerce and Labor Committee anytime soon. Because they don't like, you know, a lot of bills coming out of there with one no vote on it or whatever. There's one Democrat I know of who defends the car title lenders a lot. And what he says is that if we have, if we clamp down the interest rates to like 36% instead of 267%, what we'll end up doing is pushing a lot of this activity underground, and you'll have people making loans in the street, which will be highly unregulated, and people will be put in prison, you know, loan sharks, etc. He thinks that will happen. I have a hard time believing that, but that's what he says. So those are the kinds of responses you get from folks when you talk about it. There's increasing awareness that this is a problem. You know, the legislature feels like it's playing whack-a-mole with these guys. You know, I mean, they used to go after the military really heavily, and they would cluster in military bases. And then about 7 years ago, the Congress enacted legislation prohibiting anybody from making a loan to an active duty service member. I think more than 36%. So they got the military piece mostly under control, not entirely, but mostly. You know, every time we pass some law restricting them, then they find some other way to get around it. Like the problem with what was going on with the car title lenders was we told the car title lenders in 2011 that they had to make loans under certain conditions. And they still have their car title lender company. Then all of them created a second company, which is called a consumer finance company. And the Virginia consumer finance companies, those are the ones that have been around since 1915. And they're highly regulated, but they're allowed to lend money up to any interest. If the loan's over $2,500, they can lend money at any interest rate they want. But they're legitimate companies. They don't do that. They don't lend money to people at 300% or 500%. But the car title lenders created consumer finance companies that started doing that. And they put the company in the same storefront as the car title lender. And then they started telling people, well, we can give you a car title loan at this one, or we can give you a consumer finance loan. And they stretched it out over a longer period of time at a higher interest rate than the car title loan, and so they were doing this bait and switch thing on people. And last year I got them to get rid of that. So it's like every year, it's like whack-a-mole, you know? And but we're making progress. A couple other bills I'll talk about really quick, and then, I mean, I don't, now that you guys have this, you might have some questions for me. What else we got? So I have another bill that hasn't come up yet, but it's gonna come up soon. An education bill. If any of you have kids in school, you know that our school systems are starting to have more and more electronic textbooks. The publishing companies have started to stop giving publishing paper textbooks to kids, and all their content is becoming electronic. And the problem that creates is that if you're a student and you don't have a laptop or computer at home or a broadband connection, you can't access your educational material at home. And in Fairfax County, the system is completely switched over to electronic. All the book, they have some paper books, but they're really old. But they're all electronic. And they did that without giving every student a computer. And so, you know, you have the haves and the have-nots in Fairfax now, right? And they're very proud because they have this BYOD policy, bring your own device. Probably
such a huge disparity.
It is, and I represent a lot of the lower income part of Fairfax. And if you don't have your own device, you can't BYOD, right? So there are five systems now in Virginia which give every single student a computer. And Ryko has been doing it for over 10 years now. So has Albemarle. Arlington just announced two years ago, they're giving every student a tablet. I think it's mostly phased in now. Chesterfield County, big county south of Richmond, they're now doing it. But nobody else has done it on a countywide basis besides those five counties. Fairfax County announced this year they're doing it in one high school pyramid, one high school out of 18 or 20 high schools. Prince William County has a program called Virginia Star, where they take refurbished computers and give them to students. And there's a few high schools in Prince William County that have computers for every student, but it's not a countywide thing, and the county isn't really coordinating it. They have sort of this patchwork thing they're trying to do that sort of, you know, stem hemorrhages here and there, but not countywide. So the bill I put in, it's on my education section, it's on page, which is it? Page 3? Yeah, page 3. Right in the middle there on the top, 1335. That basically says no system is allowed to use an electronic textbook in a classroom unless they give every student a computer. And the school is capable of handling a certain type of broadband, which I'm told 98% of schools have. That bill passed the Senate last year. It died in the House in a committee by one vote. And so I'm hoping it comes back again this year and passes. We'll see. The school systems hate it. In Fairfax, they estimate giving every student a computer will cost them about $50 million. So in Prince William, my guess is it would cost about $25 million. I haven't heard a specific estimate, but you know, that gives the Board of Supervisors heartburn. It's a lot of money. That's what it costs. And I have some creative ideas about how to pay for it, but anyways, that's a bill that still hasn't been heard yet. It's coming up. You'll also notice I have a couple of higher ed bills. A lot of people are really angry about what happened to UVA. I don't know if... Does everybody here know about UVA and the problem they have? No? Okay. So, it turns out, I guess about 6 months ago, or 8 months ago, UVA voted to create what they call a strategic reserve fund, which nobody knew it existed, until somebody on the Board of Visitors, who just left the Board of Visitors, sort of blew the whistle on it. Over the last 10 years, the University of Virginia has managed to squirrel away $2.1 billion in money. I'm not talking about private donations or something in their endowment, but this is profits from their operating accounts, from tuition, from the operation of their hospital, from student fees. But they basically, you know, the school has basically made a profit of about $1.2 or $3 billion over the last 10 years. And then they made another $1 billion of profit using that money and investing it on the stock market and on bonds and other things. At the same time, by the way, they raised tuition by 50%. Okay? So when we heard that UVA had squirreled away and they banked $2.1 billion, by the way, that's four times the size of the state rainy day fund for the entire state of Virginia. If they had squirreled away that amount of money while raising tuition by 50%, a lot of us were really upset. So we started asking questions. It turns out that VCU has put away over $1 billion. Virginia Tech has about $400 million. Our other schools, though, don't have anything close to that. I think the next after that's about $30 or $40 million bucks, something like that. But those three are sitting on about, so what is that, three, four, almost $4 billion cash. So we've had a whole bunch of bills come through this year to deal with that. I introduced two bills, or three. One said, let's study this and see what's done around the whole country to try and figure out what everybody else is doing. Because I don't know what a proper reserve is right for a university or not. All our universities are different. If a university operates a hospital like UVA or VCU, that's very different than just having a four-year college. Some schools are bigger than others, et cetera. I mean, UVA's whole budget is I think they have a $2 or $3 billion operation going over there. So anyways, I put in a bill to study it, get us some data so we can decide what to do. That's one bill. Second bill said that nobody on our board of the rector and the vice director, that's the chairman and the vice chairman of the body that governs the school, has to be Virginia resident. The way in Virginia, our universities have some independence, but they're governed by these people that the governor appoints. And every governor puts on new people, typically big campaign donors, and typically people who really want to be on their school's board because they really love their school. And my concern has been that these visitors, the people on the board, are there looking more out for the school than they are out for taxpayers. That, you know, you get, especially if you get somebody from out of state, right? If you get somebody from California or New York or, wherever, what do they care about Virginia in-state students, Virginia taxpayers, or, all they care about is I want to make, William & Mary the best university in the United States of America, and they really don't care about keeping it affordable or keeping the tuition down for in-state people or any of that stuff, right? So my bill says that if you want to be either the rector or the vice rector, you have to be a Virginia resident. We can have out-of-state residents for the other spots, but just the leaders have to be Virginians. And that bill passed the Education Committee on Thursday. It'll be on the floor on Monday or Tuesday. It's also passing through the House. Again, I have a Republican co-sponsor on the other side, Delegate Steve Landis. He's the Vice Chairman of the Appropriations Committee, Chairman of the House Education Committee. I think it's got a pretty good shot of passing. The third bill I put in says that no university is allowed to raise tuition unless they give the public 30 days notice and they allow an opportunity for public comment. And they have to send every student an email explaining the potential tuition increase and why they need to do it. And so I want to get more information out there and then have a discussion about it. Right now, we just tend to find out about the increase in a press release. And so tuition in this state is really out of control. I went to James Madison University. I'm public educated 100%. Fairfax County Public Schools, went to JMU in-state, and I went to UVA for law school. My UVA law tuition was $8,500 a year back in 1996. Today, you go in-state at UVA, it's $42,000 tuition. That's not living expense, this is the tuition. My tuition is $8,500. It's gone up by five times since I left. Okay? And, every lawyer that comes into my law firm walks in with $150,000 of debt before they even start thinking about getting a mortgage. So, this all this stuff is out of control, and we need to have better transparency on it and controls on it. That's why I put that in.
May I go back to the electronic books?
Uh-huh.
Giving a student a computer so that they can access an electronic book is a good idea, but what about when they go home and they don't have access to the internet?
Yep. No, that's a problem. And
are there going to be some maybe lower subscription fees?
There are, and the problem is that nobody knows about it. So Comcast has a problem. Every year I see Prince William. They may hear Fairfax? Yeah, that's right. Sadly, right? Yeah. Even Cox has a program too. Fairfax is Cox, Prince William's mostly Comcast. Comcast program is called Internet Essentials. And I can't remember if it was Cox, somebody wanted to do a big merger, I can't remember who it was. And as part of the merger, the FCC required them to do a deal for low-income internet access. And Comcast, they call it Internet Essentials. And basically, if you're a family that does not have broadband already, you want to sign up for it. If you meet the requirements for free reduced lunch for schools, then you can get internet for $10 a month, broadband internet at home for $10 a month. And but the problem is that the schools aren't allowed to tell the cable companies who those families are because of federal education privacy standards. You know, we don't want information getting out about who's free reduced lunch and who isn't. You know, kids start making fun of kids about it. And that's also one of the reasons that my legislation says that the laptop has to go to everybody regardless of your income. Because if there's some kids walking around with a school computer and others that aren't, then the kids start knowing who the low-income kids are and who isn't, who doesn't have money and who does, and that could be a real problem in school. And so that's why my bill says everybody gets the same computer. So, but the broadband piece at home, that's what, that would hopefully plug the gap, but I can't change federal law to say, you know, how the, who we can tell. And,
but a parent could produce proof that they are on free and use lunch to get the bill.
Yep. But you're a Woodbridge school board member, Lori Lynch, just walked in.
Good morning.
Yeah. We're right in the middle of talking about electronic textbooks and computers for kids. So, we've been talking about, she came and visited me in Richmond at the school board about a week ago, and we've all been talking about that a lot. So, so anyways, that's out there. What else? I mean, I can talk about all these bills endlessly, but I'm here mostly to hear your questions and talk to you all too. So,
hey Scott.
Anybody got questions?
Did you mention coal ash?
Oh yeah, coal ash. So, yeah, I'm in Prince William County. I'm talking about coal ash. Does everybody here know what the coal ash problem is? Anybody not know what it is? I mean, feel free to raise your hand if you don't know what I'm talking about. I'll have to explain. Anyway, we want to resolve. So. Down in Dumfries, if you go down, Route 1, right as you're coming to Dumfries, there's a light for Possum Point Road. You go down Possum Point Road down to the very end, runs right along the north edge of Quantico Creek. There's a piece of land that right out there in the Potomac looks like a possum's head, and it's called Possum Point. And it's right above the Quantico Marine Corps base on the river. And out there, there's a massive Dominion power plant, opened in, I think, about 1940. Something like that, 40, 44, something like that. And they burned coal until 2001, 2 or 3, 2003. Frank says 2003, I think that's about right, yeah. And so when you burn coal, you gotta do something with the end product, right? And so how many acres they got out of this? Is it 500 acres?
A total, yes, yeah. And the ponds equate to 120 acres of that.
Yeah. Okay, so they got 500 acres, 120 acres of ponds. And by the way, this is all sitting right next to the water and also right next to Potomac Shores. We're about to put 4,000 houses in there. Right. So it's right between 4,000 houses coming in and Quantico Creek. You have 120 acres of ponds. And basically what they would do is they would, after they burn the coal, they take the stuff out, haul it out back, and just dump it in a pond. Because that way the ash doesn't blow around. And the ponds, the first three ponds, were literally right on the water. And they all filled up and got too small, so then they built another big pond up the hill on the other side of Possum Point Road, and then they built a really big pond right next to that. It's got a big dam. The dam is probably 200 feet high, something like that, holding all this water and coal ash back. And they dumped this stuff in there for 60 years. And about 5 years ago, they had one of these coal ash ponds, dams broke in Tennessee, and millions of gallons of coal ash and water went flying into a couple rivers, created a Superfund site. And the EPA finally said, maybe this isn't the best way to store this stuff. And so the EPA started passing rules to say what you have to do. In the meantime, there was another coal ash pond in North Carolina that had a sewer pipe running under it. The pipe broke, and all this coal ash went into the Dan River, which left North Carolina, came into Virginia, went back into North Carolina, created another big cleanup problem. And that happened about 2 years ago. So EPA came out with its final rules, and they charged the states with implementing their own systems. And so Virginia is in the middle of trying to figure out what to do with all these plants. So basically what Dominion Resources is proposed to do is dig up all the ash from the three old ponds, or the four old, the three really old ponds, the one kind of old pond, and put it all in the newest pond, and then actually they pump all the water out of the pond first, which is a big problem, right? Because I mean the water's been sitting there with all this toxic stuff in it. And they gotta get the water out of the pond and get it somewhere. So what they proposed to do was to just pump it out, and treat it a little bit, and pump it out into Quantico Creek. Before they did that, they actually released 20 million gallons of water without telling anybody. And EPA is still trying to figure out whether to violate them for that under the Clean Water Act. But basically they had this dam, they basically knocked out a couple boards of the dam and all this water went flying into Quantico Creek. Well, they claimed it was on the top of the pond, so it must not have had any stuff in it. Then they wanted to pump the rest of it out. The Prince William County Board, Frank led the charge on this, the Prince William County Board thought the proposal to empty the rest of the water out wasn't a good plan, and the Prince William County Board ended up suing them and negotiated a solution where they had to really clean this water really carefully, a lot more carefully than the state had required them to do. And so they put a $1 million treatment system, or I don't know, it's an expensive treatment system out there, and they started pumping water out, and then they discovered that didn't even work, and they had to shut it down. There was too much selenium going in. And so, that's all on hold right now. In the meantime, there's also all the people that live around this thing trying to figure out what it means for them. And Dominion and DEQ and the Virginia Department of Health were claiming that the groundwater was fine. There's nothing in the groundwater, don't worry about it. There were some private organizations that came in and test people's wells and found dangerous levels of lead, boron, chromium, some other stuff that's really good for your complexion. You drink a little bit of it. And I finally got DEQ to order a new testing well network, because the two testing wells that were closest to people's homes had failed like years ago and hadn't produced data for years. They drilled these new wells, tested the groundwater, and lo and behold, found out there's some pollution down there. And so about 3 months ago, Dominion announced they're going to hook up every single home to public water down there because their drinking wells are just not good. So in the meantime, we have this stuff leaking out. Dominion wanted to pump the water out. And this is all in Prince William County, okay? And Dominion wants to leave this stuff in place for the next, 100, 500,000 years, whatever. They want to put a cap on top of it. They want to pump the water out, put a cap on top of it, put a rubber seal on it, some dirt, some grass, keep monitoring the wells and just see how it goes. That's their proposal. I would like to dig it all up, haul it out, and put it in a modern landfill. And that's what they're doing in North Carolina and some other states. So I put that bill in last year. It failed on the Agriculture Committee by a 6-6-1 vote. This year I put that bill in again. I also put in a bill requiring them to study everything more before issuing a permit. They're actually in the process of issuing the permit right now. I'll talk about that in a second. My third bill requires them to recycle this stuff and then sell it. So I did some more research and I discovered that I called the Virginia port, the Port of Virginia. There's three big ports on the East Coast. There's Charleston, Norfolk, and then there's New Jersey, New York. And it turns out that we imported 600 cargo containers of coal ash into Virginia from China last year. And we do that every year. Because they like to use coal ash to make concrete. It's really alkaline, like limestone or whatever, and it causes the concrete to fix. And in Virginia, we don't have enough of that stuff, so we have to import it from other places. We don't have a reliable supply of it. And so in Georgia and South Carolina, they're using coal ash recycling as a big part of their cleanup plan. But in Virginia, it's not even being discussed. And so my bill basically says that the Department of Environmental Quality has to require our utilities to recycle as much coal ash as we imported into Virginia last year, every year. And that will be paid for by ratepayers, by you all. The cost of recycling will be paid for by ratepayers, because if we don't do that, the price of it won't be competitive. We'll be able to sell the stuff after we recycle it. So, and it's not a big cost compared to what we pay for everything else. I mean, we have all kinds of environmental compliance we pay for, like, you know, carbon dioxide and sulfur and mercury, all that stuff that has to come out of electricity here, because the smoke would burn anyway. So, anyways, I have those three bills. And over the last 3 weeks, I've been having some lengthy conversations with Dominion Resources and APCO. There's two big utility, investor-owned utilities in Virginia. There's also NOVEC, by the way, but they don't have a coal plant. But I discussed with them about actually doing something this year, and I'm actually very, very, very optimistic we'll pass something this year. Even in light of the fact that we're getting a Trump EPA, it's not likely to do anything for the next 4 years. I say that full seriousness. I mean, I don't think EPA is going to do anything for the next 4 years, and neither does Dominion. But, you know, when we get the Elizabeth Warren EPA or whatever in 4 years, yeah, who knows? So anyways, you know, the utilities, I think, would really like to try and deal with this problem now. And so we're actually having, right in the middle of a bunch of meetings, and I think we might actually get some progress on it. And Frank is very, Supervisor Principe is very interested in this. The Prince William Board is very interested in this. There's a whole kinds of parties around the state. There's actually five big coal ash ponds in dumps in Virginia. Most of them are in heavily minority areas. In Chesapeake, just so you have an understanding of the scope and scale of this, in Chesapeake, the Chesapeake Power Plant is built on an island of coal ash in the middle of the river. They just dumped it into the river to create land. And so it's a pond inside of a coal ash island, and then next to that they built a coal ash golf course. And they dumped it all over the place to make a golf course. And now nobody wants the golf course because they think it's a big liability risk. This stuff is all over the state in places you'd never imagine, polluting our groundwater and our rivers, and it leaches out stuff that's really bad for you. Hexavalent chromium is one of the biggest things that leaches out, and the movie Aaron Brockovich was all about that. Anyways, and it's right here at home in Prince William County. So if you live in Prince William, it's something you need to pay attention to. And like I said, we're about to put 4,000 houses right next to it. So you'll be hearing about that soon, huh?
There's no issue with using the coal ash in concrete that it will leach out of concrete?
No, they've been using it for years. No, the concrete industry loves it. They think it's great. It takes the place of Portland cement. It's actually better than Portland cement for making concrete. The interesting part of this problem is that, you know, I've had these bills in, and the concrete guys have come to me and said, please, 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 we want to know what's going on. We'd love to have that coal ash. The coal ash recyclers have come to me and said, we want to be in the discussion. I've had two landfill lobbyists come to me and say, we'd love to dump it in our landfill. It's like, I mean, you'd be surprised about the people that are interested when you put these bills in to show up at your office, huh?
Yeah. Right after I got your phone call about this meeting, I got a call from Potomac River Peoples about the public meeting.
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention
on the 16th of February too.
Yeah, so DEQ. In order to do this, Dominion has to get two different permits. They have to get a water permit, which they already have, to get the water out of the pond and into the river. So they got to get rid of the water before they can put the top on it, right? The water permit's already been issued. We had a big fight about that. I don't know, 8 months ago. And then they have to get a waste permit from DEQ. And because they're gonna have a permanent landfill waste storage facility there for coal ash. And DEQ is right in the middle of that process. DEQ issued its draft waste permit about a month ago. And they had an information session Tuesday night, about 4 days ago in Woodbridge. And there's a public hearing on February
17th? I think it's
16th. Yeah, it'll be on my website, my blog, and my website and everything, but yeah. But they're having a public hearing at Potomac High School to take public comment on their proposed waste permit. And again, I don't like what they're proposing. It's not something I agree with, but it's important for people to come out and express their point of view about how they're proposing to deal with this. Again, it'd be my preference to dig it all up, haul it away, and put it in the landfill, a modern landfill, not this one. I'll get in a second. A lot of people on Possum Point Road don't like that because they don't want all these trucks going up and down there. I mean, you're talking literally about 20,000 trucks truckloads or more. I don't even know. It's a lot of trucks. I'd like to see it moved by rail car. You know, all these plants have access to rail because that's how they got the coal in, right? But apparently it's more expensive to move the stuff by train than by truck because you have to put it in a bag. You have to get it from the coal ash site to the railhead, and then you got to put it in a bag, and you got to put the bag in the train, and then you got to move the train to wherever, and then you got to take the bag out, empty the bag, and then carry it over. And whereas if you just put it in the truck, drive the truck and dump it. So apparently all those steps make it more expensive to move by train, and I'd like to see it go by train, but anyway. Richard, do you have a question?
You're talking about the current situation, and I might be naive on this, but what about, I'm assuming they're still producing coal ash, or not?
No, they switched over to natural gas in 2003 at that facility, and they haven't burned coal there since. And coal, they'll never burn coal again. Coal's not coming back. There's too many problems with coal like this. I mean, it's just dirtier, it's expensive, it generates more carbon dioxide. We don't know where the president adopted the Clean Power Plan, you know, I think it was about 2 years ago now, and Trump has said he's going to repeal it. But I have a hard time seeing all these utility companies going back to coal. It's too expensive for them to be shifting back and forth and dealing with this. They're throwing around billions of dollars in investments, and most people think natural gas is here to stay for a while. So, good question before I get her follow-up.
What about Quantico Marine Base? I know they used to produce a lot of electricity with coal, and down just as you go down by the airfield.
Yeah, poor little Quantico Creek. Quantico Creek is a. I haven't heard about any of the other creeks in Prince William. I get a lot of information about Quantico Creek, partly because they have a friends group there. A lot of people live on the creek, and so they contact me a lot, but. Quantico Creek is actually heavily polluted. First of all, because they used to mine there. There was a mine in Prince William Forest Park back in the turn of the century. Frank, what was it? Was it pyrite or gypsum or something? Or
gypsum, yeah.
Yeah. There's some rock, there's actually some bluffs way back in the woods. They mined gypsum. Back in, the turn of the century, you can imagine what their environmental controls were, right? And so Quantico Creek is already polluted with all these mining tailings and mining runoff from, 100 years ago. Most of it doesn't do anything. It just sits there in the sediment. It's been buried, but if you stir up the sediment, then it gets nasty. The Marine Corps base used to really pollute badly, and there was an assessment that was done in 2001, which the friends of Quantico Creek gave to me, which assessed sort of what the status was of all that. But there's no coal ash. I don't think there's any coal ash on site, but the base does have some leaky stuff that's still problematic and historically leaked, and I have a whole report on that if you want to see it. But most of these things are sort of not causing active problems. But the coal ash is, if you all saw that how big this was, this is 120 acres of toxic sludge, right in Prince William County, right on the river, okay? And most people don't know it's there because you're not driving over there. But if you go out on the river in a boat, this plant is a big, big, big plant. And you drive by the dam, you can see it on Possum Point Road. The thing goes way up in the air. And if you're in a plane, you can see it's just 120 acres of gray sludge right there. So, your question?
Just before we leave the subject of Dominion completely, and this is not Prince William, so you can be really generic, but there's the pipeline issue, and I understand there's also legislation about how they can expand their nuclear power plant. Could you just tell me where those are going this year?
Yep, those are big issues. I never hear about it from my constituents, but they're actually big issues. They affect everybody. So, we've had a big natural gas boom in this country. A lot of it started in Pennsylvania. It's fracking. And does everybody know what fracking is?
Yes.
So, fracking is actually growing in Virginia. There's a bunch of companies just applied for a bunch of permits to start fracking on the Northern Neck. Basically a piece of land between the Potomac and the Rappahannock. And this year they also introduced legislation that would prohibit even Virginia's environmental regulators from being told what chemicals are being pumped into the ground. My subcommittee heard that bill on Thursday, and we got the fracking companies to back off and at least give access to the environmental regulators. They won't agree to let the public see what they're pumping in the ground, but they'll at least let the regulators see. In other states where this has happened, where they've done fracking, there's a great movie called Gasland. If you have an hour to watch it, it was an HBO movie, you can watch it online. But basically, in Pennsylvania, there's places you can go where you can turn on your water faucet and you can light the water on fire. Because it's so full of natural gas when you turn it on. But anyways, this fracking thing is going on all over the United States, especially out west. There's a lot of it in the Marcellus Shale in Pennsylvania, there's a lot of it in New York, there's a lot of it going on in Wyoming. And it's caused the price of natural gas to come way down because the supply is going way up. And all these companies want to figure out how to get this natural gas to users. And so they want to build two pipelines in Virginia. One kind of through the middle of Virginia and one up in the south of North Carolina. And you know, in order to build a pipeline, these companies have to come in and condemn everybody's land and then you know, tear down all the trees and bulldoze it through and build it. And a lot of people there are unhappy about it. The governor has already signed off on it. I think the FERC, Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, has to sign off, and they're likely to sign off on it. There's some bills pending, I think, to give landowners some more rights when their property is taken in that process. I'm open to talking about that. I've started to do a little condemnation work as part of my law practice, and I've sort of seen what can happen when we take people's property, destroy their business or whatever for a road or for pipelines or whatever. But I'm not sure the pipeline bills are going to get very far. I don't think they're any in that in the Senate. They're coming through the House if they come through. So that's one category of bills. The nuclear power plant, though, I mean, and by the way, the cost of that pipeline, you know, you're likely to be paying for that in part to the extent Dominion. You know, Dominion's a regulated monopoly, and you tend to pay for whatever Dominion spends, mostly, not always, which plays into the second issue, which is the nuclear power plant. So most people don't realize that 40% of our electricity generation in the state of Virginia is nuclear. There are two big plants in Virginia. There's Surrey, which is down Middle Peninsula, kind of just north of Waynesburg across the James River. And then I think there's two reactors there. And then there's two reactors at North Anna, which is Lake Anna, right off I-95. It's kind of outside out of mine stuff. But Dominion has filed an application to build a third reactor there. And I tend to be supportive of nuclear power because it's not carbon. And you know, as far as I'm concerned, I know there's a waste problem with it and there's other issues with it, but I tend to think that if it's not carbon, then I'm cool with that. But the environmental community doesn't like nuclear. Aside from the waste problem, they say that if you were to take the amount of money it takes to build a nuclear plant and you're to put it into solar, you generate a lot more jobs and a lot more sort of economic activity without the pollution. And so that's kind of the argument that they make. You know, but the problem in Virginia is our electricity is so cheap, it's hard for solar to be even competitive. It's competitive in other states where electricity is a lot more expensive, but in Virginia it's not. And just right now, I'm a big solar, I put in like 10 solar bills, and I put in all kinds of bills to make energy more green. There's a lot of moving pieces to this, but right now this power plant is in the process of being constructed. Dominion's spent about $1 billion so far on the permitting process. I think they have to spend another $4 billion to build this thing. It'll probably take like, I don't know, 10 years to build. And the problem is that the way you guys' utility bills works, they can typically build a coal or gas plant in like 2 years. Nuclear plant process is 10 to 15 years long. Yeah. They're allowed to start recovering that cost from you guys through your electricity bill after the plant goes online. The problem with nuclear is they have to front, if we use that system, they have to front $5 billion before they're allowed to start getting it back from ratepayers. And so Dominion has a bill they're coming through where they're trying to propose that they are able to start recovering the cost their investment before the plant goes online, which means you start paying for it before they're actually using it, which is kind of a change. And I haven't fully evaluated that and decided whether I like it yet or not. We did give Dominion $800 million. They were supposed to rebate $800 million about 3 years ago, and we allowed them to use that to pay for part of their nuclear costs. So it didn't cost, the only cost to you guys a rebate. It would have been like about 10 or 20 bucks on a rate pay or something like that. So that issue is bouncing around. It's very important that we look at these things very carefully. I mean, you know, because these guys are regulated monopolies, right? I mean, they don't have no competition. It's why it's critical that the state have a regulator that is really regulating and overseeing them carefully and not just approving everything they say. So that's out there. And it's going to come through eventually. And that whole debate, by the way, is playing into my coal ash fight, because the coal ash problem is becoming a very expensive problem as well that you're going to end up paying for as ratepayers. And Dominion, I know, and in my conversations with them, they're a little worried about the two of them kind of coming together in terms of the cost it might inflict on ratepayers as part of this whole discussion. So that's out there. I'm surprised you know about it.
We'll talk later.
Okay. So anyways, but there's a whole bunch of other issues we deal with. I mean, you can see it in here. I mean, there's criminal justice issues, there's civil justice issues, there's a lot of education issues. I put in a universal background check bill.
Okay, so I just wanted to ask you about the two bills that are coming up that are, this is about gun violence prevention. There's Senate Bill 1440 and House Bill 2265 that, first of all, just to say that it appears now that Virginia is one of the states where gun deaths have exceeded automobile deaths by automobile. That's a frightening statistic. Apparently, these two bills that are going forward are looking to weaken the provision for concealed carry.
Is it the constitutional carry bill?
Yes, Senator Dick Black's bill.
So,
yeah, that's not going anywhere.
Okay, right now. Well,
the governor will veto that if it gets out.
Right. I just wanted to find out your position on these proposals and also what concerned citizens can do to let their representatives and senators know that if there's no, I mean, right now for concealed carry, you need a background check, you need training, you need local court clerk approval. If it becomes that anybody can have
judge approval.
Sorry?
Judge approval,
yeah. So I meant to start out by thanking you for everything you do for us, all of what's in here. And it's nice to have a politician that we can feel very favorable about these things. So we appreciate all your help for all the Prince William and Fairfax County issues. But I just wanted to be sure that you went on record saying that you
were support and I forget what the name of the organization is, but the Virginia Firearm Prevention, Gun Violence Prevention Group is the biggest one. They work with every town. And they asked me to carry their universal background check bill this year for them. And I put in that bill that died on a... Actually, not even a party line vote. There were actually two or three Democrats that voted against me. Somebody, my law partner, actually, pointed out that John Riggins gave a shotgun to every member of the Hogs, and that my bill would have made that illegal without a background check, and he didn't like that. And so,
I was
going to
ask you what the opposition to universal background checks could possibly be.
People just don't like the big government interference in these things. That's the main thing. But all my bill said was it said you can transfer a gun to a family member. You can give it as a gift to a family member. You can transfer it pursuant to your will. If gun trust now, you can gun trust. All that was accepted. So all that is fine. But if you want to sell a gun to somebody, whether it's, you know, in your backyard or on eBay or at a gun show, whatever, you have to have a background check done before you sell it. and the state had to make those available. And that, I think I got four votes, maybe four on courts committee out of 15, something like that. So, according to polling, it's supported by about 87% of the public. So I didn't get a whole lot of discussion about the bill. I just got the question about the hogs from my law partner.
Unfortunately, it seems until gun violence affects a particular person that, Andy Barbara Parker, whose daughter was killed on television in Roanoke.
Mm-hmm.
These people become sensitized to the issue and try to help that happening to another family. And, you know, I think in the legislature, unfortunately, until it visits somebody's family, they're not going to understand.
Yep. Yeah. No, you know, in Virginia, we had the second biggest mass murder ever in Virginia Tech, and that didn't seem to... The senator that actually represents Virginia Tech still opposes my bill, I think. He's a Democrat. I'm not sure how many people have to die for people to change their position on this stuff, but the gun rights movement is very organized, and on Martin Luther King Day, you know, we always have about hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of firearm advocates to show up. I had 30 people in my office, you know, asking me to, you know, hold the line against the kinds of bills that I put in. And they feel very passionately about it. Not many constituents. I don't hear from many constituents about it. I had one constituent who came to see me on that day who was pro-firearm. Most were anti, and most of the communications I get is great. My district is not a very sort of pro-firearm district. There are some people in my district who are very passionate about it, and I hear from them, but not a lot. But
3 years ago on Martin Luther King Day, I was with a group of gun violence prevention folks, moms and grandmoms and kids, and before we went into the state building, we were asked to put down our little American flags that were on little wooden sticks because they could be used as weapons.
Yep.
But the NRA guys went in with their...
Yeah, I don't know if you saw, I gave a floor speech 2 years ago. I gave a floor speech 2 years ago on that day, where I brought into the chamber all the list of prohibited items that we weren't allowed to have. And I had some balloons, and I had a Zuzula. Remember in the World Cup, those things you blow and make noise, you know? And you're not allowed to have noisemakers, balloons. I had a siren, a red light siren thing. I pulled them all out and I said, we're not allowed to have any of these things. But you're allowed to bring an AK-47 in. Actually, not only into the state, into my office, you can actually bring it to my office legally, you can bring it to the state capitol and sit in the gallery with an AK-47 in your lap, as long as you have a concealed weapon permit. The governor has banned firearms from all state buildings, but he doesn't control the capitol or our office building. One of my colleagues brought an AK-47 on the floor of the House a couple years ago. I'm not going to do that because it makes people, it just inflames things, but firearm debates have become heavily politicized in Virginia. We're just kind of all at loggerheads right now about it. I mean, last year we actually had the first movement, more restrictive legislation since Doug Wilder passed last year, because the Attorney General ended up saying that we weren't going to grant concealed carry reciprocity rights to about 30 other states. And a lot of concealed carry holders got really angry about that because they're used to being able to conceal carry in all these other states. And after he came down with that ruling, they came to the table and we enacted two bills to give them those rights back. One says that as soon as a protective order is granted, a firearm holder has to give up their gun immediately while there's a protective order in place. That wasn't the law last year. And they had 24 hours to turn their gun over to somebody else, just get it out of the house. And it was the second bill we passed too. I can't remember what it was. I think it was another
domestic.
It was a domestic violence, something with domestic violence. And I can't remember exactly what it was, but anyways, that happened last year. I don't expect any movement anytime soon otherwise. So. on the other hand, people like this.
Past sessions, Medicare expansion was a big issue. Is that dead now?
Medicaid
expansion was. Is that dead now, given that the Congress is going
dead, to dead, dead, dead. Dead is going to be dead. With what's going on at the federal level, with Obamacare, we're not talking about Medicaid expansion at all anymore. We're also.
I'm wondering, are your Republican colleagues saying, "See, I told you it was good not to sign on to it." I mean, are they saying things like that?
No, we're not even really talking about it. The big discussion this year has been about COPN. Anybody know what COPN is? Probably nobody knows what COPN is. So, again, an issue that affects all of you all a lot. Probably don't know anything about it because it's never in the papers, but in the state of Virginia, if you want to open a new hospital, or if you want to build a surgery center, or if you want to have a new MRI machine, there's a committee you have to go through. To get what's called a certificate of public need. And we created this system to make sure that we didn't build too many hospitals or too many MRI machines or too many surgery centers. And we have this system. It's a very delicate balance right now. And because by limiting competition in these areas, we also require a lot of these hospitals to do a certain amount of charity care. And so, for example, a lot of the Innova system does a whole lot of work for people they don't get paid for. And what's happened is that some of the for-profit medical companies, like HCA, Healthcare Corporation of America, they're really active in other states, not as much in Virginia, because they've been able to break in if they want to. They want to come in and open hospitals in Virginia and sort of take only the paying customers, leave the charity care to the others. And the others are like, you know, right now, basically what happens is Innova, Centera, they basically use their sort of higher profit center, whether it's like their MRI facilities or their surgery centers, to subsidize the charity care they give in emergency rooms and otherwise. And so if you, there's a free market crowd that wants to come in and blow up COPN, Certificate of Public Need, get rid of it, and just allow the free market to take over. And what that'll mean is it'll mean that it'll screw up all the pricing on everything. There's also actually a lot of doctors that want to do it. In a lot of other states, for example, doctors will invest in surgery centers and send all their patients there so they can make money on top of the money they make. So we've been getting a lot of pressure from the Columbia HCA and from doctors to blow this thing all up so we can have a free market system in Virginia. And our current system seems to be working okay, I think. I think there's some tweaks we can make to it. I don't think the system works totally perfectly, but that's been most of the discussion this session is about whether to do something about COPN. And before Medicaid blew up, some people were looking at COPN as a chip to trade for Medicaid expansion, but now the Medicaid expansion is off the table. And healthcare is all, nobody knows what's going to happen with healthcare, what's going on across the river. Nobody wants to do anything right now, I think. So we're all waiting to see what plays out at the federal level before we start doing anything more at the state level on healthcare. That's, I think, where we are. So it's complicated, huh?
I saw, I read this morning where a couple of Democrats are going to put a bill in that to require anybody that runs for president in the state to have to show their tax returns.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that?
I could sit and talk about Donald Trump forever. I never thought we'd have to come to that in this country. I mean, we have every president's released their tax returns since Nixon, I think. Yeah. And especially with Donald Trump's, all the things that he's got going on in his business, I think it's important we'd be able to see that. You know, I have to file a statement of economic interests, which tells people what kind of stock I buy. I own rental property. I have to tell people where I own rental property. I have to show them what businesses I'm on the boards of. I have to say where I earn income from. I have an economic disclosure I have to file. He has to file one too, but tax returns really give you a much better peek into that. And given his job, I think it's important that we be able to see that, to be able to make judgments about what he's doing. And so I think it's a good idea. I mean, I don't like federalizing, taking all these federal issues and putting them in the state code, but given his behavior, you know, it's becoming necessary. But the billing didn't go anywhere.
Yeah.
But it's been introduced. So, I mean, if I have to vote on it, I'll vote for it. Not unhappily, but I'll vote for it. So, that's where I stand on that. Any other questions? Yeah?
I wanted to know what research, if any, annual proposed legislation has been done on using China for transportation to DC. I know that you're doing a lot of work on Route 1, and I like that you have a very clear statement of everything that needs to be done, and what the state, where the process is. But I wanted to know what options you have in your.
I wish you'd asked that question about 15 minutes ago before Frank left. They've been studying forever. Yeah, Frank, your Woodbridge supervisor, Frank Principe, that's one of his babies, is he calls it the fast ferry on the Potomac. And he's a huge advocate of that, and he could give you much better information than I could. My understanding is that 2 years ago, somebody looked at it. I want to say it was either COG or the Northern Virginia Regional Commission, somebody did, and said that it would not be economic without massive government subsidies. And I believe that the NVRC, the Northern Virginia Regional Commission, has adopted or endorsed the concept of trying to do some ferrying service starting in the Alexandria area, Old Town, D.C., and to see if they can make that work before they start extending it south. And I think that's kind of where that is, although I have no idea where they are on implementation of that. One of the big problems is that the military bases have refused to give access to their landing facilities because of security concerns. They'd have to set up a whole new security apparatus in order to handle people being dropped off there, and then they have to get them from the dock into the base somehow. And that, they have concerns about that.
The majority of people coming in don't even go to that area.
I still ask downtown. Okay, so as downtown, you're coming in. Okay, sorry, I can be back in Delaware every day if you take the ferry one way. You know, by the way, New York, so unless you work at the New York, you still have to come around and through downtown and compete with all the traffic coming from Maryland to get to your job. So I mean, the current system I was lugging, I still think is the best option after that. And my next question was going to be, are we going to continue to have a PRTC? I know it's not like the world's best system, but oh yeah, you know what, one thing I totally forgot to mention. Oh, I totally forgot this. So, and I'm sure that you have a question. While we're on the transportation, I'm surprised I haven't got any transportation questions yet, because Prince William County, that's always the top of the list. but the Commonwealth Transportation Board just announced its recommended funding scenario. About 2 years ago, we enacted a bill called House Bill 2, not to be confused with North Carolina's House Bill 2, which required every transportation project to go through an objective formula to decide whether or not it ought to be funded or not. And basically what we look at in Northern Virginia, it's required 60% of the score you get is congestion reduction. And then they look at safety improvement, economic development, and environmental improvement. And then you take that score and you divide it by the cost of the project, try and figure out where taxpayers get the biggest bang for their buck once you consider all those things together, right? We're trying to make our transportation spending decisions in terms of where can we spend our limited dollars in a way that will have the biggest improvement for everybody and take the politics out of the road funding decision. So that, for example, you know, like 5 years ago, Chuck Colgan got a $180 million interchange by voting for the budget, right? Up in Gainesville. We want to take that kind of issue out of the discussion, right? So Prince William County put in a whole series of funding projects, or a whole series of projects, and so did Fairfax. Prince William County's proposed projects would have consumed more than the entire amount of money that was available statewide. Okay? Fairfax County put in two projects in my neck of the woods, between Fort Belvoir and actually between Woodbridge and Wilson Bridge. And those two proposals would have consumed a third of the budget alone. I mean, so that this gives you the idea of the need that's out there and how much money is actually available. So the good news is that VRE put in a proposal, and they got one of the biggest proposed recommended awards. It was recommended to give VRE about $90 million for longer trains, longer station platforms, and increased capacity to make VRE move faster. So that, I mean, reason BRE did so well is because they take cars off 95, so their congestion scores are way up compared to everybody else. All the Route 1 projects got creamed. So all the Route 1 projects, the ones in, and I represent Route 1 all the way down, right? But even the Fairfax County Route 1 projects, all the Prince William County and Fairfax Route 1 projects all came in number 40 through like 55 out of 60 in Northern Virginia. You had to be in the top 20 to get the funding. So, sort of good news, bad news, mostly bad news. Although, I mean, I have a lot of, the 36th district has more BRE users than I think just about anybody in the state. Okay? So, I've already had a meeting with the Deputy Secretary of Transportation to talk to him about how we can get the scores of the Route 1 projects better. And the biggest problem with Route 1 relative to the other projects is all these scores are relative. You're compared against other projects. And as long as I-95 and 66 are part of the discussion, we get destroyed on the congestion performance. Because we have congestion, but compared to with I-95 and 66, it ain't anything close. So as soon as 66 is off the table, which the next cycle is 2 years from now, if 66 is off the table, and with hopefully I-95 off the table, with the big bottleneck on the 95 is at the Rappahannock, that's getting funded right now. Hopefully that'll be off the table. And hopefully our scores will all improve. But also, remember, we also fight against other projects around the whole state. And if Hampton Roads puts in the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel, that could create a real problem for us. Because the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel is... Hey, Lily. You're a school board member, Lily Jesse, your mom, just walked in. So, anyways, it's... I'm disappointed, but there's other things in the works, and I'm trying to work with our localities to figure out if there's ways we can improve our project or our rankings on our projects. It's a brand new system. Everybody's just figuring out how to use it, the best way to design their proposals when they come through. So, but there's not a lot of good news for us on that. Now, our saving grace might be the MBTA. Those of you who remember, does everybody know what the MBTA is? Northern Virginia Transportation Authority? About 3 years, we passed a tax increase that enacted a bunch of regional taxes here in Northern Virginia to fund roads. There's a hotel tax, the regional gas tax, and I think part of the sales tax, and on a grantor's tax. Every time you sell a home, part of the money from selling a home goes into this fund. And there's about $300 million a year to spend in Northern Virginia alone. And that's spent by the NVTA. And the NVTA gets to decide how to spread that around. And that money is available. And I'm pretty sure some of that will come to Route 1. But I'm not sure how much yet. But we'll get a little bit, I think. So we're not totally destitute. So that's out there. And I can show you, if you want to go to the web, show you what the website is if you want to see it. I'm going to write a blog post about it soon also to explain to everybody what happened. All that just came out like 2 weeks ago, and another paper was written about it. Shirley had a question, and then Sally. Let me get Shirley first.
Okay. Bob, thank you. Let me say first, thank you for representing us. I think you do an exceptional job, and I'm very pleased to be in your district. And
thanks, Shirley.
My question is really to get your opinion on something. It deals with criminal justice, education, and guns. Uh-huh. And in Virginia, we are leading the pack on school to prison pipeline and suspension of our kids, most of these being children of color. And our school resource officers are licensed and trained police officers as opposed to counselors. And there has been a bill introduced where they can now carry guns, and that passed. I don't know where it is now. I think that's gonna create some serious problems because if a child pulls back from a resource officer and hits their hand or anything, they can be charged with assault upon an officer. And Prince William has a lead, Fairfax is following closely, but we're trying to work up there with them. But those are issues. But now you're saying not only can a school resource officer who is a trained police officer introduce our kids into the criminal justice system, they now can carry a gun, which means that now you can also shoot them. So what is your comment on that?
Yeah, I'm very sensitive to all that. I know as Lori gets to leave, I know that she and I talked a little bit about the kid down in Dumfries who got charged with larceny for a free reduced lunch kid.
Right.
Took a 15-cent milk carton, whatever, 45-cent milk carton. But
65-cent
milk carton, he got charged with larceny, I guess, because he had an attitude. But
it's something the school system we have right now. I'm sorry to leave. I have another meeting, but just to give you a little preview, we are looking at our disciplinary actions and where we're at and how we deal with those issues. It may come as a surprise to you, but we're kind of a leader in the state in the way that we handle our children and try not to expel or suspend them. But there's a difference between a school resource officer and the school sense of discipline. So the school resource officer is still allowed by within his rights to act as a police officer, which is separate from the school's disciplinary action. So you have two tracks within one building that a child can get caught up into. And there are many reasons for that. It does come in handy because you do want a resource officer on the premises. It's just, I would say now at a point of refining whose roles, how they should function within the building, and how we can change it so it's a better system for all of us involved. We just haven't gotten there yet. But there's a disciplinary committee, I think we enacted it last year, to go back and reevaluate how we're handling those situations, because we do recognize that Virginia's number one leader in the prison pipeline for children. We're not trying to send children there. So some of our codes and ways of doing things are not, I wouldn't say outdated, but we're at a time now where it's time to revise. So that's where we're at as far as disciplinary and SROs and things of that nature. We do make our best effort to make sure that even if students are long-term suspended or they get in trouble, they're still receiving an education while they're going through whatever the process is.
Well, we still have, as a principal, the principal there was very new.
Yeah.
And I've had cases of the principal where the officer comes in and says, this kid did this. But generally, the officer will talk to the principal because you know this kid better than he does. And sometimes they'll say, you know, Mrs. Jesse, I'm sorry, I'm just going to have to act on this. Or they get you more information. I think that's what we're also looking at. And we still have problems of disproportionalities, where we have a disproportionate number of African American boys in disciplinary situations that correlated with the literacy piece, because the literacy piece and the disciplinary piece, all of that really goes together.
It's a little bit of sensitivity training too. I mean, you think if you're a police officer, you're used to dealing with adults. Maybe, you know, they start to get nervous as a police officer. I'm guessing, because I'm not one. I'm sure that would send up some flags. Maybe there's something else going on. Well, if you're 13, you've never been in trouble, and you have the same reaction, a police officer has the same reaction you deal with an adult, it's a different situation. So I try to tell people we're working on this, but it is sort of a human business. So each individual case is a little different. So just for my standpoint, that's something that's near and dear to my heart. So I'm expecting a report to see how we can improve things.
Surely, what you were talking about is that Doug Langfelter has a bill that would allow, I think, the school disciplinary officer to carry a weapon if they are a former law enforcement officer. And that bill got vetoed last year, and then he made some changes to it based on the governor's veto statement about training. The person has to have some additional training before they're allowed to carry the gun. That bill passed the House with some Democratic support this year. I think there's only 17 votes against it, maybe.
And to my understanding, it's optional, too, if the school system wants it to have.
I don't know. I have to look at that.
I think we were in his office talking about language in there that it's not a requirement for school systems to have the SRO carry a gun. It's if you want to take advantage of it, still leaving some of the authority.
But I think we should be fighting for SROs to get more counselors in the school, not police
officers. No, sure. Yes. In general, I don't like SROs being in school, period. I mean, when I went to Fairfax County, when I went to West Tongues High School, I don't think we had a police officer in the school. We had security guys.
Around the 90s.
Right. Yeah, now when you have a law enforcement officer in the school, like every time they see a crime, I think a lot of times they feel like they gotta charge it. And that to me is, you know, kind of counterproductive. I mean, you know.
Well, in this case, he really didn't know the child, because the child is also on free or reduced
lunch. Yeah.
So that means that he could have free milk.
Right.
Because he's on that free and reduced list. And so
not
knowing that, because the free and reduced list is a private list. Right. So there were a lot of
But this is something that goes on around the state, and I'm just talking more of a state level.
No, it is true. I mean, listen, in Fairfax, we were having a real problem with suspensions.
Yes.
And you were in the middle of that.
Yes, I am.
About 4 years ago, And I requested the suspension data from my high schools, and I found that I had to sort the suspension data, the suspension rate by race. And the data was really stark. I mean, if you were black or Latino, you're a lot more likely to get suspended for behavior than if you were white. And there were also significant disparities between schools. And different principals would suspend at different rates within racial categories, even though the demographics and economics were the same. And interestingly, and I couldn't figure out what to read about this, but it was actually, but actually the schools that had the higher suspension rates, at least in the Mount Vernon area, had African-American principals.
That's exactly right, yes.
And I had a longer discussion with a couple of people about why that was the case, but it's since changed, but at the time that was what was going on. And actually, one of the principals was a former Marine.
Oh, that was good.
And right, and the other one was the daughter of a former prison warden.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
So, there's a lot of equity issues wrapped up in all that, and I'm very, you know, Virginia is number one.
What do you think about carrying guns though in school?
I don't think guns belong in school. Period. But. And although, by the way, when I was a senior, we played the 1812 Overture in band. And I know when we wanted to, my band director was in Tennessee, and when he wanted to simulate the cannon fire, he actually shot shotguns into oil drums in the back of the auditorium. You know, back in then, you were allowed to have guns in schools. 1988. But anyways, I don't think guns belong in schools today. Sally had a question. We'll go back to you. Yeah.
Actually, in the context of transportation, I was going to ask you about the status of the high-speed train. And
yeah.
I also wanted to ask you, if EPA implodes, does the state have sufficient autonomy to kind of protect its own resources from
yeah.
back to the EPA?
So that's another thing going on that most people in this part of the county have no idea is occurring, but it's kind of important, is the Rules Committee of the Senate put me on the South, I forget what it's called, the Southeast Corridor High Speed Rail Commission or something like that, or the High Speed Rail.
Just High Speed Rail Commission.
High Speed Rail Commission, okay. There's a coalition between us states in the Mid-Atlantic to develop, they call it high speed rail. It's really not high speed rail like you see the bullet trains, whatever. It's more higher speed rail. Trains that speed up by a lot, but not like the bullet train speeds. But there's a we're currently on what's called a Tier 2 environmental impact analysis for implementing high speed rail between, I think, New York to Raleigh, and that main line comes right through Prince William County. And in order to do that, it's going to require a lot of improvements and upgrades, and they actually just came out with their draft proposed environmental impact statement. And I actually just talked to my staff last week about setting up a place where people can look at it and make comment that I can then forward on. But I know, Sal, you live right next to the rail line, and there was some concern that they might be shutting down one of the access points under the railroad, and they confirmed with me that's not one of the proposals. So you all aren't going to lose that access. But they are going to have to widen. They're going to have to put another track down. There's a proposal to put another track in, so the footprint of the rail line is going to get bigger. And where the stations, which stations end up getting used for access to high-speed rails is kind of important for economic development purposes. And my guess is there will probably be a stop in Woodbridge. I'm not sure. I can't remember if that's on there or not. But given all the growth that's going to happen in Woodbridge, I mean, Frank can tell you, the amount of volume Frank is getting in terms of new projects they put in Woodbridge, high-rise condos and apartments, is incredible. He's got like five multifamily projects he's trying to consider right now. And you know, they're putting the, I think, 800-unit or 500-unit condo right over here overlooking the Occoquan at Rivergate. It's going to be a beautiful facility. It's going to be big. I mean, think about it. You know, 500 units, probably 800 people living there. Maybe it's 800 units. I can't remember, but it's almost one voting precinct worth of people on that piece of land. So,
Who now overflow.
Right. Yeah, they have to get somewhere. But the reason what's driving that demand is VRE. People want to be close to that VRE station, you know? VRE means jobs, quick way into D.C., And so this high-speed rail thing is going on, and they just announced the proposed EIS about 2 weeks ago. And I'm going to put out an email about that, telling people to go read this, give me comments so I can send it on. But for some of those who live in Belmont or, you know, Woodbridge, whatever, forget, huh?
Could I just take a minute or two to talk about overcrowding and relationship with...
Sure, give me one second. Yeah, and Sally had another question about EPA. I expect EPA not to do anything for the next 4 years. Under the Clean Water Act, Clean Air Act, everything, Virginia's DEQ has the authority to independently regulate. I'm not sure how much authority EPA has to veto us. I need to look into that because that's going to become a problem. Usually, under the last administration, you know, if we want to be more aggressive about environmental issues, that's never been a problem. But Virginia typically doesn't do that, but some states do. So I'll look into that and find out what the answer is. I don't know the answer to that. But we do have independent authority to enforce. And Lily was going to talk, and you can ask a question.
Okay.
Lily wants to talk about overcrowding in the eastern part of the county and our schools over here. So go ahead. Uh-huh.
In my platform, I talked about overcrowding. Everybody talks about class size reduction. The problem that we have is overcrowding, especially on this eastern end of the county. And we have the situation where the Board of Supervisors wanted to expand the decorative portion of a school. They wanted a battlefield model, which was a simple model. They asked for it, the Republicans did, but the community responded. And so now, for three times, they came before the board to ask us to move it from being the battlefield model, which is a simple model, to the Patriot model, which is about $160,000 million in cost. It was rejected at the school board level. They had no way of bringing it back. So they brought it back to the board of supervisors. So we have what was called almost a bribe, where they told us they will give us $10.6 million for all the problems we have on the east if we allow them to expand and remodel the school that they're going to have built in 2021. And so it passed because some of the Democrats went along with it. And so I've been asking for reports, and I was surprised. I knew that we were overcrowded over here, and I knew that there were two schools in that Woodbridge district where we actually have outside facilities for second graders, where they're going to outside bathrooms, and most people don't know about that, and I've known about it for quite some time. So I asked Mr. Klein to give me a graphic, and you can see that in 2005, we had 123 trailers on the east, outside trailers, and that they had 62. When you go to 2016, what do you see? We have 118, we still have 118 trailers. The western end has 10. There are at least 23 schools on the western end that are undercrowded, below 90%. That new school, Wilson, that all that community came out and said, we want a community school. They chose not to go to that school under some military option. They did not go to their neighborhood school. They went back to Ashland, is now at 70% capacity, and next year is going to be close to 60% capacity. So they're moving kids from these schools on the west because they don't have the capacity for this. And what I think that this is something that, as Democrats, whatever differences we have, that we can focus on in terms of overcrowding. We really, for Lake Ridge, they've given us three. We didn't get a school because there were fights about the land. We didn't get a new school. Instead, my three schools in Lake Ridge are going to get additions. Now, initially, the school board said there was no room for an addition. But now they found a way to do that, and that's taken away playgrounds and all these kinds of things. So that means that all of our kids on this end are going to be moving. They're going to, because once you, they've got 13 classes, that means some of the schools, maybe some of the surrounding schools, their kids will be taken out of those schools and moved to another school in Lake Ridge, rather than giving us a brand new school. So Harry, I can't believe I'm agreeing with Harry, because Harry and I fight like cats and dogs, but Harry is right. We have asked for nothing, and they keep saying we're being Democrats, you know, we're, we were taken over, and but this is what happened on the Republicans. They just continued to build on the West and to remodel and add to on this end. I was principal at Vaughn, and I guess I didn't think about it because that's just the way it was. I walked into that school, I had 5 trailers, I had no lunchroom. My food was brought from across the street. Then I had about 5 remodels. When I left Vaughn, now Vaughn now has 9 trailers. Moromsco Hills has 12 trailers. They can't even do tornado drills correctly because they don't have, when they bring all those second graders in, my deal is second graders should never be in trailers because during tornadoes, trying to get 5th graders to come in, as a principal, the first thing you do is get in, get these kids out of the trailers. But when you have second graders, the second graders in trailers here, and the second graders in trailers in Moromsco Hills. So in Occoquan, all along this eastern corridor. So now they're building these new condos. We write letters to the Board of Supervisors, said, please, check with us and make sure we have schools availability, and they ignore. And so now we've got all these condos coming in, and that may be great for some part of the economy here, but it's not really great for the school system. So I appreciate you for listening.
You hit this as a partisan issue, but isn't it also caused somewhat by finding a location where you can build a new school? I know what I'm hearing from the county is that some of the areas are having more new students and not even a place you could put a school. And so somehow we're looking in the county to how we locate those things. So.
Well, part of that, the Board of Supervisors has some responsibility in that, right? Because there are pieces of property that we were going to build up by chin, and the teachers or parents came out. The person that came out were people who were concerned about it being parkland, and really, to be honest with you, they talked about the owls and how we have to save the owls, and the owls won, so we didn't get that property. Now we're working on another property along that corridor. There's also land at Garfield High School, and some of the people there have controlled that. There's land by Woodbridge High School that is part of county property. So they have been blocking in many instances us getting the land. The other thing is just a space situation. When you continue to build condos all down Route 1,
exactly. Yeah.
You don't have space.
All, you know,
so that means that for us, I've been saying over and over, you've got to start thinking outside of the box. And we've got to start thinking about using commercial properties possibly for schools. We need to think about, when you start talking about building vertically, we're going to have to start really thinking about using less property, maybe 10 acres of land, and building. Yeah. But I think
in Arlington, their high schools are not like 4 or 5 stories, and I know Bailey's Crossroads, they're using like, a 6 or 7
yeah,
stories.
Yeah, I went to that school. I've been working on this.
That's what we're going to
talk about. Yeah. I've been working on this for 3 or 4 years, and it's very frustrating for me because I went to Bailey's Crossroads. There was a building there, and they put their 3, 4, 5 students in there. They gutted that building. That place is beautiful if you've been inside of it. There was a building behind Occoquan, and Occoquan has 10 acres of land. And I said to Central, you guys need to go down there and look at that situation because we could probably build a structure, but with a different format and an architectural design for those kids. But then Occoquan, by the way, is a nationally recognized school, one of the 2 highest performing schools in the state of Virginia.
Title I.
94% pass rate in math. They were going to take 100 kids out of Occoquan Elementary, they just got this national status, live next door to Occoquan, and move them across the street down to Belmont that has the lowest performing rate in the state of Virginia. And I had to fight that. So I do think that we have a lot of issues. I'm new to politics. There are a lot of things that we disagree on, but I do think that this whole boundary issue and this overcrowding issue is something. For example, when you look at the amount of money they give us for class size reduction, that grant that they give us from the Board of Supervisors, gives us another teacher.
Well, if you don't have room for a teacher, that only works for those people on the west that have the space. It doesn't work for those of us on the east. I had that situation. If you gave me another classroom when I was at Vaughan, there was no place for me to put people. They've added on to Vaughan, they keep adding on to our schools, which means the principal has to do two jobs. She has to be principal of that regular school. Now she's gonna have 300 or so kids coming in. She's gotta hire people, she's gonna have two jobs, and some of those people in Lakeridge, I know Lakeridge people, they're not gonna wanna move their kids anymore. We're moving our kids around. They've got empty seats waiting for their kids. There's where the inequity is.
Yeah, so it's now 11:03. We've been at it for 2 hours, surprisingly. I can't believe it's taking 2 hours, but I think you have a question.
I agree with you 100%. I just hope if they move the baseball stadium from Pittsburgh down to Little Boy, you got that cheap chunk of land sitting over there. We got to turn that into a, you can build a lot of plants. Yeah.
So I can stick around for another 10 minutes. I have a meeting. I go to 11:30, another town hall at 1 o'clock. But anyway, thank you all for coming out.
Thank you.
Please make sure you're on my email list. You're on my email list to get information. Make sure you like me on Facebook. I put a lot of stuff on Facebook because there's so much going on. Please stay in touch with me. I really appreciate you all coming out today and taking the time to come out.
Thank you.